This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
Today, the Israeli Housing Ministry issued new offer bids to build 100 homes in two Israeli settlements in the occupied West Bank.
According to an Israeli government spokesman, these buildings are not new, but rather an expansion of the two settlements.
الاستيطان النكبة الفلسطينية المستمرة يتجدد في ذكر النكبة.
Settlement expansion is an ongoing Palestinian disaster, renewed during the anniversary of the Nakba, the catastrophe. This is how many Palestinians summarize the increased Israeli settlement activity in the West Bank. The Israeli Housing Ministry issued offer bids to build 100 new homes in the West Bank settlements of Ariel and Alkana. These settlements are included in the number of settlement blocks that Israel plans to keep in any final agreement with the Palestinians. But according to the Israeli Peace Now movement, which opposes the settlement expansion, this move is Olmert's Passover gift to the settlers. It eliminates the hope of reaching an agreement with the Palestinians and turns the Annapolis agreements into what is described as a farce. Aside from the U.S. opposition to settlement expansion and the Palestinians' protests, this issue has various implications on internal Israeli politics. For Ehud Barak, this project is compensation to settlers for evacuating arbitrary settlements. For Ehud Olmert, this is a way of competing with his political rivals to show that his agenda includes actions and not only words in regards to settlement building. According to the latest Israeli polls and common knowledge, the current settlement plan is the largest since the 1990s. It corresponds with strict Israeli policy towards Palestinians who live in the areas under Israeli security. More than 90% of building applications by Palestinians are rejected, and when they build without a permit, the Israeli authorities issue orders for demolition.
وحين يضطر هؤلاء إلى البناء من دون ترخيص تصدر السلطات الإسرائيلية أوامر بهدم ما يبنونه.
The Israeli occupation forces imposed a complete closure on Palestinian territories for the duration of the Jewish Passover holiday. The closure began at midnight last night and will continue until the 27th of this month. Palestinians will not be permitted to enter Israel except for humanitarian cases, according to them.
In another escalation, the Israeli occupation forces assassinated Hani al-Kaabi from the Al-Aqsa Martyrs Brigades, the armed wing of the Fatah movement, in Balata refugee camp near the city of Nablus in the West Bank. 19 Palestinians were also arrested in various areas in the West Bank.
The camp of Balata in Nablus woke up to the sound of Israeli military machines. This scene is not uncommon to the city or its camps, even though the majority of resistance fighters had announced their commitment to calm. They refrained from carrying out operations against Israel, and many of them turned in their weapons to the authorities. Hani al-Kaabi, an active member of the Aqsa Martyrs Brigade, was targeted by the Israeli army. They surrounded him in a house, and when he refused to turn in his weapon to the occupation forces, he was martyred. Another member from Al-Quds Brigades was also arrested before the army withdrew.
I think that the Israeli military offensive is aimed at imposing a one-sided calm in Gaza, in line with the calm that the occupation forces have imposed on the West Bank. It aims to continue pressuring the Palestinians to change their consciousness, break their will, force them to stop resisting, and make them accept the solutions that Israel imposes.
The Israeli military operation in Nablus was not the only one. The occupation forces also arrested 19 Palestinians in different parts of the West Bank. Meanwhile, a total closure was imposed on the Palestinian territories for the Jewish Passover holiday. Workers and worshippers returned home when military barricades prohibited them from entering Jerusalem and Israel.
On Friday in particular, people want to go to pray. If a person wants to go to pray, where will he go? If a 60-year-old man wants to pray, is he going to fight? He's just going to pray.
We came out this morning peacefully to go to work, but then they said it was closed. We don't know what to do.
Imposing the closure, which will continue until the 27th of this month, is a routine procedure in the lives of Palestinians around the Jewish holidays. Under the pretext of fearing attacks and the heated situation in Gaza, the Israeli police decided to intensify its presence in public marketplaces, transportation stations, and around Jewish temples. Meanwhile, more barricades were set up at the entrances of cities. Perhaps Israel prejudged that it will be impossible to reach a final solution by the end of the year, but in turn, it has not offered any accommodations to ease the lives of citizens, as it had promised. On the contrary, it has intensified its blockades and increased its arrests and assassinations. This supports the widespread belief that peace has become only a one-sided demand. Shireen Abu Aqle, Al Jazeera, from Qalandia Crossing, southern occupied Ramallah.
In other news, former U.S. President Jimmy Carter today took his self-styled private peace mission to Damascus, where he's slated to hold meetings with Hamas political chief Khaled Mashal. The planned meeting with Mashal angered Israeli government leaders who refused to meet with Carter while he was in Jerusalem this week. The former president will return to Israel next week and is scheduled to address the Israeli Council on Foreign Relations following his talks in Cairo, Syria, and Jordan. As part of his efforts to include Hamas in the peace process, Carter met with officials of the terror group earlier this week in Ramallah and in Cairo. The Haaretz newspaper revealed today that in a meeting with the former U.S. president on Monday, Deputy Premier Eli Yishai of Shas issued a message to Hamas that he would like to meet with their leaders, including Mashal, in order to expedite a prisoner exchange that would free kidnapped IDF soldier Gilad Shalit. Carter also stated that his talks with Hamas leaders could potentially lead to a breakthrough.
Leaders of Hamas, would they accept a proposition that if there was success between Abu Mazen and the Prime Minister of Israel, and they reached an agreement on all the issues, the major issues, and if they were then submitted to a referendum of a Palestinian community, and the Palestinians approved, would Hamas accept that agreement? And the answer was yes.
Once again, we welcome our guest, Dr. Hayat Hawayek. We will follow up with news reports that were aired on Israeli television. Since Israel was established, there has been a division between those who use Judaism to justify political Zionism and Orthodox Jews who view Zionism as an attack on God's will and traditional Judaism. However, the two groups were forced to reconcile for the sake of the Jewish people. The solution to this problem, however, only postponed dealing with the problem between the secularist and religious Jews rather than resolving it. This explains why problems arise between the two groups whenever the secularists violate religious laws such as the Sabbath or other religious holidays. This conflict between the secularists and religious Jews in Israel shows that the two groups cannot live together, at least for now. Let's have a look at this report, which was aired on Israel's Channel 2.
Status quo is a Latin word that means the current situation. Before the establishment of Israel, Ben-Gurion sent a letter to the Agadat Israel religious party saying that the status quo in Israel will be as such that Israeli kosher food will be the official food in the country, the education will remain independent, and couples will marry in the traditional Jewish way. Why was this letter written? Because leaders of the religious party opposed the establishment of a Jewish state. The crisis emerged once again due to differences over education and the recruitment of Jewish women in the Israeli army. The Mivdal party left the government over disputes on how to define who is a Jew. After the Yom Kippur War, there was a modernization movement in Israel. Restaurants and cinema theaters began to open on Saturday. In 1967, a new crisis took place when three military planes conducted an air show on Friday. The ministers who attended the event were forced to leave before the Sabbath started. The Mifdal Party was outraged, and its ministers were forced to leave. This happened during the last years of Rabin's first term. In 1999, Egudot Hatura resigned over a dispute on how to transport an electricity generator on Saturday. 7 years later, the Shas party did not leave the government and only protested the violation of the Sabbath, thus avoiding a political crisis. Ben Ilan Street in Jerusalem is one of the symbols of conflict between secularists and religious Israelis who want to close the street on Saturday. The secularists, however, need to pass through the street to go to their homes. The conflict has led to violence and has preoccupied politicians for the past 20 years. An agreement was finally reached not to use the street during prayers. The stores that sell pork and open on Saturday can still cause a crisis within the government. Nowadays, there is yet another crisis over the yeast law. The crisis, however, is still at the beginning stages, and we'll have to wait and see.
There is another crisis in Israel caused by the complicated relationship between the religious and secularist groups. Is Israel a modern country, or is it a biblical Jewish state? This is where the problem lies. You have written about this subject matter extensively.
I researched this. In reality, the Israeli social fabric suffers from three fault lines, and together they cause a great division. The ethnic fault line between the Mizrahim and Ashkenazim Jews, the religious fault line between the secularist and religious, and the class fault line between the rich and the poor. These three fault lines can be found within the Mizrahim Jews, who tend to be poorer, more oppressed, and more religious. This increases the gap between them and the Ashkenazim.
Mm-hmm.
Let us focus on the divisions between the religious and secularists.
Yes, the division between the secularists and religious is the most serious one because it relates to the foundations that Israel was built on. The state and the entire Zionist movement were based on religious justifications, the chosen people, and the promised land. This creates a contradiction. Early Jewish immigrants came from the West, from secular societies, and they want to prove to the West that they are modernists and secularists. Yet at the same time, the Zionist movement and Israel were based on religion, which is why it was called the Jewish state. How can these two contradictions reconcile?
Mm-hmm.
On April 18th, Qana's wounds deepened, asking the heroic leaders, who is holding Israel accountable?
يكبروا شهداء قانا والمنصوري والنبطي الفوق سنة في عمر استشهادهم.
April 18th. Another year has passed since the passing of the martyrs in Qana, al-Mansuri, and the Upper Nabatieh. On April 18th, the Lebanese people commemorate the 12th year of waiting for the truth to surface. They wait for the punishment of the murderers who committed their crimes in broad daylight, during springtime, under a tent shaded by the flag of the United Nations. Inside that UN tent, the bodies of 107 Lebanese citizens, children, women, and old men were turned into amputated body parts and burnt corpses. On April 18th, the Upper Nabatieh remembers the infant, Nur al-Abid, while Qana remembers the second miracle of a nation standing united around its martyrs in the south. On April 18th, al-Mansuri remembers its martyrs in the ambulance car, unveiling once again the faces of the Temple Mount's thieves and the sons of serpents in Israel. Israel, the only one in the world skilled in the art of killing children.
وفي تفاصيل تلك الذاكرة أنه عند الساعة 2:10 من بعد ظهر يوم 18 من نيسان عام 1900.
For the 12th year, Kana recalls a memory that will never grow old. The details of this memory are as follows. At 2:10 p.m. on April 18, 1996, Israel launched 17 155 caliber long-range rockets, some of which exploded before hitting the ground. The rockets were dropped from a height of 7 meters over the Biji troops in the town of Kana, targeting 3 shelters housing citizens from Kana and neighboring villages. The 17 explosions were followed by moments of silence. Fire, smoke, and shrapnel created a pit of mass execution and a massacre that ended the lives of 107 civilians. Amongst them were 33 children whose body parts mixed together and pierced the bodies of others. As usual, the tender bodies of the children in the south testified to the failure of Israel's power, breaking its might with their will. Israel settled for a simple apology, saying that what happened in Kana was a mistake. The massacre was added to the list of Israel's countless slaughters of Lebanese and Arab civilians, from Palestine to Lebanon. Kana and the south will not forget their martyrs, and their wounds deepen with each passing year. But the tombs of the martyrs question the authorities, the guardians of leadership, freedom, and independence. Who will hold Israel accountable for its crimes against Lebanon? The sovereign, the independent, the free Lebanon.
وهو برسم السلطة وحراس السيادة والحرية والاستقلال. أين ملف مقاضاة إسرائيل عن جرائمها بحق لبنان السيد الحر المستقل؟
Today, which coincides with the 25th anniversary of the explosion of the American embassy in Beirut, George Bush renewed his support for the government of Fouad Zanioura. The same position was reiterated by the head of the Middle East at the State Department, David Walsh, who has been meeting with Lebanese political officials in Beirut since yesterday. These meetings come only 2 weeks before a new parliamentary session that will be held to vote for the new Lebanese president. Eliane Chatry reports from Beirut.
During the sudden and unannounced visit of the head of the Middle East Department at the State Department, David Walsh, to Beirut, he reiterated American priorities pertaining to the Lebanese political crisis. Walsh reiterated the need to elect a new Lebanese president without any delays in all his meetings with Lebanese officials.
I told the Parliament Speaker that many people in Lebanon and the international community, and of course the U.S., hope that the Parliament opens for business and elects a new president immediately. The Parliament is the most suitable place for dialogue.
Walsh did not bring with him new positions or initiatives. He only reiterated his country's support of the Lebanese government and its sovereignty, and the Arab Initiative and International Tribunal Court. The main reason behind his visit was to attend the ceremony that was held at the American Embassy in Beirut to commemorate the 25th anniversary of the explosion of the American Embassy in Beirut. A similar ceremony was held in Washington.
This was an occasion to make political contacts, and that is what happened. However, the political implications and environment goes beyond remembering the explosion.
Political observers raise questions about the implications and possible results of this American intervention in the Lebanese internal debates, especially when considering that it coincides with the ongoing preparations for holding a new parliamentary session to vote for a new president for the country. This session, which is already sensitive, is vulnerable to any political positions, especially if it comes from Washington. Walsh's visit broke the political calm in the Lebanese political arena. It coincides with preparations to hold a new parliamentary session, which was postponed 18 times. It seems this time will not be the last time, despite the American emphasis on the importance of electing a new president.
أصدرت الحكومة الكويتية قانونا مثيرا للجدل يضع قيودا على التجمعات العامة إثر معارضة.
The Kuwaiti government withdrew a controversial law that bans public gatherings due to strong opposition from the civic society and political groups and activists. The cabinet has agreed to postpone the issuance of a decree to control public gatherings and turn it into a draft bill, which will be forwarded to the next parliament that will be elected in May. Meanwhile, an Islamic Kuwaiti political group said that it will cooperate more with the government after the parliamentary elections next month, which may speed the passage of past due political reforms.
The Kuwaiti people and all political parties have agreed on one thing, that is the withdrawal of the law banning public gatherings without pre-approval from the Interior Ministry.
We are confirming that if this draft law passes, it is destined to fail. This draft law will not be passed by the next parliament. God willing, it will be rejected. The Kuwaiti people reject it.
Political parties believe that this draft law censors them and limits their freedom, which they have been accustomed to for a long time, without any clashes with security forces and anti-riot police.
أو مكافحة ما يسمى عرفا بالشغب.
لا يمكن أن نقبل مثل هذه القوانين مثل هذه الجرائات.
We can never accept such an unjust law. Our love for the country and our efforts to cooperate and maintain harmonious relations with the authorities are a legitimate demand and must be protected. We can never accept a law that was produced by the executive branch of the government only to be revoked by a constitutional court. This shows the kind of thinking by the government and its recklessness. The government takes civic institutions lightly, makes decisions for the Kuwaiti people, and expects them to be subjugated. We cannot accept this. We will only accept freedom, and therefore this draft is unacceptable, and it will be defeated in the next parliament if it is not withdrawn soon.
The government ignored this public condemnation and started raiding tribal gatherings and clashed with them. This raises a question. How will a society that has been accustomed to democracy and expressing differing opinions since the establishment of Kuwait react? The draft law that bans public gatherings clashed with the Kuwaiti people and all political parties, which have been accustomed to free speech and gatherings for whatever reason they wish. Raed Al-Mutairi, Al-Madar Program, Kuwait.
Raed Al-Mutairi, Libernamaj Al-Madar, Al-Kuwait.
Greek and Turkish negotiators have been meeting Friday to lay the groundwork for talks aimed at ending the island's decades-old ethnic divisions. Communities have been divided since Turkey invaded in 1974 in response to a brief Greek-inspired coup. But as Tim Friend reports, for one village, the political situation doesn't really impact on their day-to-day life.
It's got a mosque and an Orthodox church, a Greek cafe and a Turkish coffee shop, all within a few meters of each other. Nothing unusual about that, except this is the divided island of Cyprus, and the village of Pila is unique. It's the only bicommunal village in the UN buffer zone separating northern and southern Cyprus. Now, as talks aimed at reunification after 34 years gather pace, Pila is being held up as an example of peaceful coexistence.
These tank traps on the edge of the village are a remnant from the 1974 Turkish invasion. But even then, the villagers made a pact to stick together.
Christophorus Andronikos has lived here all his life and says the villagers have got along through compromise.
We never speak politically, you see. We just avoid to have a political situation and discussion and so on. Just, if they need our help, we could offer them. If we need their help, they could help us.
It's a lesson for the island's leaders as they try to break the political deadlock.
With goodwill, respect, tolerance for the rights of both communities to exercise their educational, religious rights, I think these are the major points that really help both communities to live together in Pila.
They get on well because we don't have any other alternative. If we aim to contribute into peace, we have to keep our good relations. Can this be a good example? Well, this is the message from this village. Yes, we are an example.
Whether Pila's experience eventually translates to the whole island is now down to tough negotiation. Tim Friend, Al Jazeera, Pila, Cyprus.
Former President Carter meets with Hamas and outrages Israeli officials. But why did he make Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas uncomfortable? And is he on a mission for peace or mission impossible? Answers to these questions and more on Link TV's Mosaic Intelligence Report.
Shunned by Israeli political leaders, former U.S. President Jimmy Carter met with a Hamas representative in the West Bank and says he will go ahead with plans to meet with the leader of Hamas and the Syrian president in Damascus to promote peace in the Middle East.
It's very important that at least someone meet with the Hamas leaders to express their views, to ascertain what flexibility they have, to try to induce them to stop all attacks against innocent civilians in Israel, and to cooperate with the Fatah as a...
More than 20 Palestinians and 3 Israelis have been killed in a bloody week of heavy fighting in the Gaza Strip. The surge in violence came after a relatively quiet month and threatens to unravel Egyptian effort to mediate a ceasefire between Israel and Hamas. Hamas has also recently changed its military tactics towards Israel, emulating Hezbollah's methods with hit-and-run operations across the Gaza-Israel border. According to an Israeli official, Hamas has also been plotting to kidnap Israeli soldiers using methods learned from Hezbollah.
The Hamas terrorist regime in Gaza continues to try to kill Israeli civilians, and they continue with their military buildup. The Israeli Defense Forces are acting to protect our people.
Hamas officials said that Jimmy Carter's meetings with the Palestinian militant group will boost its legitimacy.
This meeting shows that it is not possible to ignore the Hamas movement. We benefit from this meeting because we can explain our plight, positions, and principles. Our plight is just, and we are committed to our principles. We demand lifting the unjust siege imposed on our Palestinian people.
According to my insider source, Carter will try to mediate the release of captured Israeli soldier Gilad Shalit as a goodwill gesture on Hamas's part in order to gain international acceptance. Hamas is seriously considering Carter's proposal. So is former President Carter on a peace mission or a mission impossible?
I will try to do my best to push toward a peace agreement with the Israelis and the same between Fatah and Hamas. However, I'm not a negotiator. I'm someone who might provide some communication, and I will meet with Mishal and the Syrian president.
Carter's meeting with Hamas officials has not outraged just the Israelis. It has been criticized by the U.S. administration and presidential hopefuls, including Barack Obama. It also embarrassed Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas, as several members in the Palestinian Authority I've spoken to believe that any negotiations with Hamas would effectively undermine his authority and the credibility of the Palestinian Liberation Organization. Meanwhile, according to the London-based newspaper Al-Sharq Al-Awsat, Prime Minister Ehud Olmert has offered the Palestinians 64% of the West Bank as part of a future peace agreement. Olmert told the Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas that the Palestinians could forget about territory west of the security fence. When I asked a journalist colleague working in the West Bank to confirm the report, his response was, "Did Abbas just find this out? Even the kids here know that the wall is Israel's borders." I'm Jamal Dejani for the Mosaic Intelligence Report. To learn more about this program or to share your thoughts, visit us at linktv.org/mosaic.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic Video Podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program was brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. television network devoted to global and national news with uncompromising documentaries and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.